Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I will show you how to use MLflow to track and log all the activity that you will be doing at the time that we train an LLM, a transformer LLM, and in general describe you what is MLflow and how to, you can use it in your machine learning projects. Okay, let's start. Let me find exactly here. What is MLflow? Well, MLflow is a library, a Python library. Well, it's essentially, it's not only Python, can work with other languages as well, like Java or R. And it's a library which is designed to leverage the whole machine learning process. And then from experiments that you made the design to do training, to do a fine tuning, not only LLMs, it can work as well with any conventional machine learning library, or scikit-learn, or XGBoost, for example, or LightGBN, or deep learning frameworks like PyTorch or TensorFlow, Keras, whatever is broadly used, this library, and is fully integrated as well with most of the main technologies that you are using today, like Databricks or Azure Machine Learning Studio, tools like that are working in the machine learning lifecycle process. And again, usually, this library was designed initially to work with scikit-learn, and then on they extended with more and more functionalities, and now recently they incorporate, I would say kind of 1 year ago, 1 year and a half ago, they start to provide features or to work with LLMs, in not only training LLMs, also you can work with prompt engineering and RAG tools and many other things that now are also available on MLflow. MLflow is a client-server architecture which essentially is a server which is running in a container in a server, majoritarily Unix, which contain a front, a new UI, and also a backend, which keep and serialize all the components all the artifacts and logs that you are producing in the different phases or steps during the machine learning life. It can be used as I give you later also. I'm preparing an output as usual, where I will go through a experiment of fine tuning a tuning phase transformer. It's a very simple exercise. The aim of this experiment is not to show you how to train a fine tune a transformer, is how to do this and integrate this with MLflow and see how you can take advantage of the MLflow leverage to track all the activity that you are doing and see how easy is to do that. And later, well, even register the model, retrieve later on your model in another environment and do inference and many, many other things that you can do with MLflow. Again, this is a tool which is broadly used and integrated with most of the technologies that you may know, like Databricks, like Azure ML Studio, or SageMaker, or Vertex AI. You can work it in a standalone application and just integrate it. Again, it's an architecture client server. You have a client which is essentially running on the application side, where in your notebook inside a Python package. You can also have it in a endpoint running, and then on this client connect to a server side, through a URI, and then you can log all the activity or what you are doing in that server. I will show you now how to set up the components and how to, well, with an example in that case, very simple example of fine tuning an LLM, how it works and what you will get using this library. In previous videos, you probably saw that I use weight and biases. Is well, the concept is exactly the same. Probably you, if you watch these videos, you probably hear me that they are pretty similar the tools. And when you know one, you probably will know how to use the other. Probably you will know MLflow for a long time because again, it's a tool which is already mature on this field on machine learning. Is here for some years. I will say more than 6-7 years on, and they extend it with many functionalities, and you can take a look to the documentation. You will see how many things you can do, and is integrated not only with the tools, as I said, like ML tools, like Databricks, is also integrated with most of the frameworks. And the integration is such that you can just simply with two lines of code just keep track of everything that you are doing with that algorithm, model, or framework, no? And then automatically log all the your activity in the MLflow server, and you then can keep track of what happened in that specific experiment with that specific configuration, and later you can compare as well different experiments, different runs with different parameters, and this way during either the modeling phase or the deployment phase, you can do as much as experiments you want. You have track, you keep track of everything, you can create notes, whatever you can imagine that and is necessary for to leverage the machine learning project lifecycle is included in MLflow. It was designed as a set for that purpose, and it's just extending again with more and more functionalities, as well with some other languages. You can work with R, with Java API. You have also a RESTful API just to work, to interact with the server, with the MLflow server using just HTTP requests. And but again, you had also R and Java available libraries. We will work with Python as usual. You can take a look to the traditional ML, all the libraries that they integrate with. So whatever you can imagine, they have a framework which allow you to work with any kind of model in a similar, exactly same way of deploy the model, train the model, upload the model, register the model in the model registry, retrieve the model for further inference, deploy the model into a Docker container, into an endpoint in a technology like Databricks or Machine Learning Studio. Whatever you think, everything is having an standardized API, SDK, and you access to any model that is integrated with MLflow using the same commands and the same exactly classes, the different flavors, different tastes, as they say. And you can see here traditional ML, all these libraries. You go to deep learning, you have different ones as well, different MLflow integrations. You have here plenty of stuff. We will take a look today to human phase for a specific LLM, but what you will notice here, as I said, just with two single lines where you configure the access to the MLflow server, you will be keeping track of everything that you are doing in your experiments. Again, as I told you, it's pretty similar to weight and biases. In some of my previous videos, I was working intensively with that because, well, it's a SAS tool that you can use whenever you are in the from any environment. You just simply make a login from your local environment. You need obviously a key. And it was very easy to, and it's fully as well integrated with Hugging Face and with many other frameworks. And well, for those that can work with an online connection in the project, it's pretty convenient. And also weight and biases we decide for integrating and do the same that MLflow, but just specifically for LLMs. In this case, as you probably also know, I say many times this in my channel, that in many of the projects I work with, I need to propose or provide solutions that work offline, on premises, or without the internet connection. So for that purposes, weight and biases is not suitable. In this case, you need to do to use tools like MLflow, which essentially run either in the same container that you are running the application. It's just a server which run in a port by default the 5000, or you can have it in a corporate infrastructure and having the behind a big database where you can keep the track of the hundreds of thousands of experiments of many people. We are going to do a simple installation today, which is which had the server and the in this case the notebook, the application in this case, on the same container, on the same machine, and I will show you as well as we are working in Colab Pro how to access to the UI of the MLflow server, how to install it, how to log data, how to integrate it with the Hugging Face, and so on and so forth. So again, MLflow is a client-server architecture. We will have both components on the same container. In this case, the container is a Unix box, which is what we get when you run a notebook in Colab Pro. Essentially, what you do in Colab Pro is just when you set at a runtime, you just create a unique Unix box. In this case, if I know wrong, is a Ubuntu or a Debian modified or personalized box, which later Colab Google give you access through some specific ports, HTTP, HTTPS, and also SSH, and you can interact with the Unix box through the UI that Google Colab provide. In this case, I attach to the runtime T4 because we are going to fine tune a model. But again, this is something that is not the main for this tutorial. Is the main is how to use MLflow and how to log the activity or the training in the MLflow server, and how to set up MLflow server together with the MLflow client, which is the size, the component which is running with the application. The application can be like today a notebook, it can be a standalone application, a package, a Python library, Pass API endpoint or a Flux application, whatever. This can be the application, and you have later a server where you send all the logs, the history of your runs or your experiments, also artifacts. It can be artifacts like a plot that you do to track the accuracy of the or your evaluation process or your training or the loss, whatever you are producing. You can produce this with a conventional Math Plus Lead or Seaborn, and these plots later you can log the artifact, the PNG or GPG file that you produce into the ML flow server and attach it in that case for that run for with this is part of the one experiment that you define in your ML flow setup. No? And then as we are working in Colab Pro, Colab Pro will not allow us to connect directly to the port 5000, which is the default port that we use to to run MLflow. We can use others, but the problem is MLflow had Colab Pro have a firewall and a reverse proxy in front of this container where I'm running this this notebook, and then it will not allow me to connect directly to the port 5000, and then to overcome that problem, and it's something that you can do in many scenarios, not only here in MLflow. Just for example, if you want to expose something from an internal network into a public space just to do a demo, give access to a dev environment, whatever you need, is a way to tunnel an application, to tunnel the port where an application is running, and you will have access even when this is behind a firewall, a reverse proxy, or is in an internal network. The only thing that you need to do is install the client or the ng arrow key and install it and then on setup a port. This will route the traffic of that application in that specific port to the ng arrow key infrastructure, and it will expose it in a public IP address in HTTPS in the port 443. All the public set in for that application in that port will be exposed in the public IP address of the that ng arrow key infrastructure will provide to you once you configure the client and the tunnel for that application. We will see this now. You will need, when you run this, you will need an account. You can set up an account for free. You don't need to pay anything. And you just will need the token, the authorization token, to set up the port forwarding of MLflow server. So the first thing that we do is to mount our drive. And we install here the MLflow. Then on we will run the UI on the port 500, just using getPython and the method system row, and this will run the server. I already have it, so this you will see once you run this first cell that you have here, you may check. That the server is running with netstat NA, and you make a grep of the port 5000, and you will see that you have the server running there in local, the MLflow server, and you can also check if the process is running with PSEF, the same graph MLflow. Okay, you see here we have it, the MLflow UI and the port 5000. Under the hood, MLflow is using Unicorn, which is an application server, and also to keep all the metadata I use a database. Usually this database is by default SQLite. SQLite is a small light database which comes with Python, with any Python implementation, and it is default, by default what the MLflow use to keep the metadata of the experiments, runs, all parameters that you log or automatically collect for the training or for the activity that you are doing. And then on also in that database there is some tables which contains links to the file system where you essentially keep the data, the artifacts. When I say artifacts, I mean models, plots, datasets, whatever you are logging, whatever artifact you are logging to that experiment, it will be kept on the file system where the Everflow server is running, and you will and the links to this access are are kept on tables on this database. For that, for the database you can use the default one, but if you are working in an enterprise environment, usually what is done, you have a PostgreSQL database or MySQL or MSSQL database where is it is used to keep all this metadata, because usually the volume is very big, and this this database SQLite is just for doing some POC, or when you are working with only one application, there is not many people interacting at the same time. When you need the concurrency of access to the backend MLflow infrastructure, you need to have a convenience database. By default, MLflow can very well, I will say, parametrize in terms of the front of the UI how it service, because working with Unicorn is running four servers at just by default, so it's managing the multi-concurrency very well. But again, in an enterprise setup, the database that is used by default is very small, and probably is not the most suitable. Is there is other integrations with are here in the documentation that you can set up and redirect all this traffic and data to a corporate database. At the beginning, once you run the server, here we are running with this small parameters, but there is plenty of parameters where you can specify, for example, what is the backend database, what is the path where it's going to be keep all the data in the all the artifacts. Again, this is can be as well not a file system, it can be a bucket or can be a file share in the cloud. There is multiple architecture options that you may need to explore in case that this needs to be run in a corporate environment. If you are working, for example, with Databricks, this is fully integrated, it's using the backend infrastructure of the Databricks workspace, so you don't need to do anything, it's already integrated with Hive and in Databricks, and it's already set up to run in a corporate environment, even though if you need to use another database, you had, for example, or you want to concentrate all the experiments in a corporate database infrastructure, is also possible, even working with Databricks or Azure Machine Learning Studio, in redirect all this login, all this metadata to a corporate database or data farm database. In our case, We are going to run it in local, and the data, the artifacts will be kept in locals. By default, you don't specify anything. In the same, the Emberflow server will create an infrastructure, three of folders, no, where starting with ML artifacts, it will keep all the experiments that you are doing. There is the first level is the experiment ID, and the second level is the run ID inside a specific experiment. I will show you now when we run that. So we run the server. Now we are going to install the PyNGROK client. With ngrok.kill, we keep kill any previous tunnel that we may have. Here with this code, what we are doing is just I'm getting the authorization token from my secrets and setting this authorization token to the client itself, and here I'm creating a tunnel from my port, local port 5000, using HTTP, which is the easiest one. Usually here what we are using is the method connect of the proxy, so we assume that in front of this we have a reverse proxy like NGNIX, which is usually how all these applications like Colab Pro are deployed, or Pass API, or whatever you are running, or in a Kubernetes environment, all this stuff usually works similarly. And then what we are doing here is just tunneling all the traffic of our that is served in the porking 5000 of our Emberflow server, using the method connect and using the reverse proxy that we have in front, we connect to the ngrok infrastructure, and then on they will expose this traffic into a public IP address. You can check it here, ngrok tunnel that public address. It creates public URL. Sorry, it creates a public IP address, a ephemeral URL where you can connect to your application. And then everything that is being produced on the port 5000 of your Emberflow server is later tunneled to the port 443 in this URL. Once you execute that, okay, you can see here, you can click here. Well, I'm using the free client. If you want to have a corporate account, it's also possible. With the free client, you only have you can use only one tunnel, and then you cannot run two tunnels at the same time. And then again, here you see everything that we can access to the Emberflow server, to the UI, and here you just have the previous two runs I used to record the previous video, and well, you can access now to the Emberflow server in the UI component. And then on, as you see here, the spam filter already had two runs. This is the experiments I did before. The run, the main parameter is the run ID. And then if you go later here, check it out. It's the run ID ending in CED1. This is this one. And then on inside the folder, you have the folder artifacts, where you keep everything that you are logging. Also, as happened with practically all the libraries that which Emberflow integrate with, all the metadata that is being produced by this Exactly. By these experiments, in this case, is also keep on the file system, and with this the method that you use by default as well, and you can take a look the same approach is been done. Is done here. The first level is the ID of the experiment. In this case, the experiment is span classifier training, and under the folder you had all the run IDs, and you make you can access as well to everything that is being produced in the during the training, parameters, all the everything that later on we will see on the UI. Okay, so one second. Let's start with the rest. Now we are going to set up this. This is conventional use of the Hugging Face library. Transformers is nothing new probably for you. So here is not the main topic of the tutorial. Is just we install the libraries, we create we are going to use a data set. This is just a copy of the one of the examples that come with MLflow. I just adapted to work in this process, and then yeah, we create we download, well, all of this, you know, the loading the distilled version case from Hugging Face. We just tokenize the map. We just tokenize the dataset, train and test dataset. So here we prepare we download the model, and we create the direct and reverse maps for our labels. We are going to train a classifier, a binary classifier here. Here, just we evaluate a metric, accuracy can be any. There is multiple. This is everything again. This is only Hugging Face training. So this is nothing to say with the MLflow. The only thing that MLflow is already knows everything. MLflow and Hugging Face libraries are fully integrated. So you will see now how with only two lines of code you can log all the activity that you are doing in your training process. So now we create the training arguments object, where the output of the training logs in local, and we define the trainer. This we do not cover this, we already see this in many videos before. And then on the first thing, the first setup for MLflow is you just set the tracking URI. In this case, is local server. It's listening in our 100 in the your local IP in the port 5000. We create the experiment. It doesn't exist. As the first time I run it, it's creating a new experiment. We can create a second one just to you test it. You will see not existing. If we create another one, so this means that now when we go here, you see here you have a second training exercise, a second experiment with another name. We don't have runs because still we didn't run. And if you go to ML artifacts, exactly. You had now the previous one, which was that one, and here this is empty. After we don't run anything, we don't have anything in ML artifacts. Let's move here. Okay. Yeah, and then just setting these two, the URI and the the experiment name. If you don't specify anything, you don't specify the experiment, it will go to the default one. Just the first time that you run the server, it's creating a default contain default experiment, and if you don't set up a name, it will go the run, it will go here to the default one. So in our case, as we already set up the URI and the experiment name, we just need to instantiate the MFlow client and start a run with the name run. This is the object that is going to collect all the metadata generated on the training. And as Hugging Face and MFlow are fully integrated, you don't need to do anything further. You just see that here is start the training. This is conventional training of the Hugging Face library. And now, if you go to MFlow, here we will have a new run, refresh. It's creating a new run in your MFlow, and you can see that it started to create metrics. And again, everything that you, by default, it will be, how to say, automatically logging to the MFlow server. You have here all the configuration of your model, all parameters of the training is automatically logged, and the metrics that have been logged for this experiment, and then you have some charts, and after that, well, here we still don't have any metrics and artifacts as well. And you see how easy it is to keep track of what you are doing in this experiment. And later I will show you as well how to lock the model into the model repository. It has a model repository here. And also retreat the model from the model repository and do inference with the model just that we will download from the model repository. This meaning that you can do this in any other environment. Here we are doing everything in local for the purpose of the video, but you will see that you may understand that you can do this in any other machine. You just instantiate a MFlow client and just point to the run ID, and you can retrieve anything. The run ID, the MFlow client allow you to do queries into using conventional, practically conventional SQL to interrogate the database and understand, for example, which you put, for example, you can set up tags for the run ID. You can go first of all to the experiment name, retrieve all the runs, organize them by date, by tags. You can set some tags, some nodes, retrieve all this metadata, and it will allow you to find the right run with the right component. Just if you just keep track on and you have configured that on your runner. You can see here these tags. For example, you can set up, I don't know, experiment of today with this configuration, whatever, and then you can find you can search in this experiment name the run that was run this day, or point directly to the run ID, you know it, or to that run which contains the tags, whatever is up to you. You can add as arbitrary tags, is text, you can add as much as you want. That allow you later to identify easily your experiment. And see, here we are already 99, a very simple dataset, and for a transformer it's pretty easy to classify this. The object run is an object for the class for Emmerflow client class, and you can interrogate the object and get access to anything that is being produced during this experiment run. Here now we are going to create a classifier, a pipeline, Hugging Face pipeline. This is fully integrated. We don't need to reinvent the wheel here. This is a pipeline type model text classification. We take the model from the training. We use the tokenizer that we create above, bus site A, device CUDA. And here we just make, this is nothing connected so far with the MLflow. We're just testing the model. And now what we are going to do is infer the signature of the model. This is also specific in the class models in MLflow. You can use this method to, and this method will understand how it will collect all the information, how the model was trained, what had the model in the model config dictionary, and it will understand that it's a Hugging Face transformer from the the model that is a distilled verb based on case. Everything that we use to train this model, from where it's coming from, it will be inferred using that, and it will keep in this dictionary. We take now signature. You just take signature, you export it to a dictionary, you can see everything that you need to that it understood to run this specific model. And later with that, another command, pretty simple, we just take the same run ID, we still didn't finish it. We take the run ID of this you just execute this run ID info run ID. You can take the ID of this run, which is that one. If you go to the MLflow, you go here, it's the 3F. Exactly the same run ID. And then on what we are doing here is just adding more information to the run. Here we are going to lock the model. With the model config we have here is the pipeline that we just created. It's the Hugging Face test classification pipeline, where we are going to log it to the fine-tune folder inside artifacts. Everything that you lock any artifact is you are logging is here, later reflected in artifacts in the UI. For now we don't have anything. And then on we didn't use any metric. And once you run it, you will see now that we go here, and then on we lock. Oops, still not. Overview. Probably we need to just refresh. Refresh. Let's check it out. Yeah, exactly. Here we just run everything, even it's giving you the path where it's working, and components, the tokenizer, the metadata you need, requirements. This is taking capturing from your local environment, because it is working in your local environment. If you want to deploy this to another environment, you just need to use the same libraries that here works. You just need to deploy the same libraries that you have in your environment. You have a conda YAML file, Python environment, the configuration of the model, everything that is the model itself, and this will allow us to later, as you will see here, so the modeling for run is also the object containing all the information that you need to retrieve the model. Now, the signature dictionary, and now what we are going to do here is load the model. So now we retrieve the model from the model from the MLflow server using the URI. Okay, this is what is producing here, model URI. So here you see it runs. This is the run ID and the folder where it was saved. So what we are going to do is to retrieve what we have here, and then on we load, and we just create, once we had loaded, we download the model here, the Hugging Face pipeline, and we pass a validation test to just to do an inference here. That's it, you have it here, and you can take here. Loader is a transformers pipeline, the classification that is exactly the same that we created here. Let me show you here. Okay. Well, that's all. Pretty interesting stuff. In my opinion, as I said, is a tool that you need to know, not only for LLMs, for anything that you are doing in machine learning. You probably already work with that. I'm just exploring the new functionalities in LLM because I had to do some stuff in a on-premise environment. And I think it's pretty interesting. It's something that I'm completely sure that that you will use. It's not in this specific environment. You probably even already use it with Databricks or with Vertex AI, with any ML tool that you have available already in the market. Many of them are fully integrated with MLflow. And you just see probably UI, because usually, for example, Databricks is just personalizing the UI. You see something slightly different, but essentially the same components is just presenting. Not very different, to be honest, because contains the same components. If you go to Azure Machine Learning Studio, it's as well redefining the UI, but same components, it has experiments, runs, etc. And if you go to other tools like SageMaker or Vertex AI, you will find the same. You can use the library, and they are using the library for collecting all these activities. And tracking what you are doing and registering artifacts, models, etc. Okay, that's all. I hope you like it. And I will upload now the notebook to the repository as usual, and then you can play with that and do your own experiments. I will be uploading other notebooks with the rest of the functionality we had available from engineering and also RAC evaluation. Some stuff very interesting as well for the topic generative AI. And well, that's all. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you like it. And if you like it, just give me a like. Subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before. Share with your friends and colleagues if you think it's also useful for them. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.